Thank you. I am so sorry, I have not unmuted my mic and I've made a note of doing that this afternoon and I didn't. So good afternoon and welcome once again to our Business Rebound webinar series. And as I said earlier on, we would are very, very pleased that you are with us this afternoon. Our guest, of course, is Mr. Thomas Schaefer, who needs no introduction. He is the Managing Director and the Chairperson of Volkswagen South Africa. Before we get started in our discussion this afternoon, I would like to observe just two things. We have a chat box where you can actually just make your comments or raise your questions. I've already received one, which I will try to factor into our discussion. Secondly, of course, you are please requested to mute your mic. And of course, if you want to raise a question, please do so, but please be precise and to the point. As is customary for us during the webinar series, we also take time out just before we get started to observe just a moment, just to observe the COVID-19 pandemic and the deaths that we are witnessing around the world, and also a silent prayer, of course, for a vaccine and an end to the scourge of the virus, as well as to also observe a moment for the social tensions we are experiencing in the world as far as justice is concerned, poverty, inequality, and of course, prosperity for all. So if you will join me just for a few moments, just to observe a moment of silence. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thomas, welcome to the webinar series. I'm glad you could make it. Buy out the time for us this afternoon. We will be, of course, having a discussion, myself and Thomas, around leadership in the crisis. As you know, this is probably one of the most important discussions today as we face a lot of uncertainty in the world, a lot of unpredictability, and a range of paradoxes that actually dog our life, daily lives. So in business, of course, as we opened the economy recently worldwide, the big problem that we will face is, of course, how do we go about reopening the economy? How do we go about reopening society and business? Of course, being mindful of the changes that have taken place, remote working, of course, the impact of technology, the restrictions of lockdown, and all of that has meant a great reset in business and society. And of course, these are the times when leaders really have to stand up and make sure that the organizations and the companies survive and also thrive in these very, very difficult times. Our topic, as I said today, is leadership in a time of crisis. And I'm going to ask Thomas just for a few minutes just to introduce himself and just to share a few thoughts about Volkswagen and the things that they are doing there as they reopen the economy and get to grips with helping our province and our city and our country, as it were, with the virus. Over to you, Thomas, and thank you very much once again.
Hello, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Jonas. First of all, let me say that obviously we all completely underestimated what hit us, what was going to hit us. I was personally of the opinion that it's going to get bad, but not that bad. I was in Asia, in Malaysia in 2002 when the SARS pandemic hit Asia hard. And you have obviously lots of deaths and that's regrettable, but it was something that the economy worked through and it went away. So what hit us here is something of a magnitude that nobody would have ever expected. And we were watching, obviously, international developments very closely, having such an extensive footprint as Volkswagen in China. Now we have about half of our business as the Volkswagen Group is in China. We make about 4 million cars per year in China. So we were obviously first to witness it firsthand what went on in China. And we, as being part of a global production footprint here in South Africa, we were trying to figure out what impact would be for us in terms of supply chains and all of that. But then the lockdown almost overtook us in those decisions. We thought we could run another 2 weeks of production because the numbers didn't look too bad, but lockdown came. And I must say it was probably at the right time as well. And then after that, the infections were on the rise, and first priority is always keeping our people safe and creating a safe environment in which they can operate. So we were then hit by almost like a double effect. No? So then about 2/3 of our business is export, 1/3 is domestic market. Obviously South Africa domestic market due to the lockdown was hit hard. No? The dealers were closed, we couldn't produce. People had a whole lot of things on their mind, but not buying cars. Little bit online business, but we can get to that later. But mainly international business sagged and it sort of slumped badly. For two reasons. One, there are countries that we deliver to that are still in lockdown, the UK. You know? So we do about 50,000 cars of our 160,000 per year go to the UK, and they are in lockdown. So obviously the dealers can't sell the cars, problem. But you had a whole lot of other countries around the world where the governments were promising incentives for buyers to sort of promote the economy and get out of the slump. And but it wasn't decided. So this sort of unclarity about incentives or not prevented customers from buying. So they were holding back, thinking there's some money coming their way. And so we've been dealing with this now for the last couple of weeks. Things are looking up a little bit globally. We've seen that China has come through the crisis quite nicely. Our plants are at full operation there again. Here in South Africa, we got the people to come back to work with an intensive program that we put in with over 100 points of safety features with screening, testing, obviously social distancing, hygienics, and all of that. People go to back to work on beginning of May, and we've been operational since then with two shifts out of our three. We can't run three shifts at the moment because we have a lot of people that get identified as potentially infected. We isolate them, and at the moment that's around about 200 people that we then use people out of the third shift to make two shifts functional. So it's a bit of a strange situation, but we make do at the moment. I'm quite happy with the progress. And the other aspect of it was that when we realized pretty early in the process that we need to come to the help of the metro, because they were dealing with also with something they have never experienced. And we had some experience with building ventilators in our sister companies in Spain. We knew how to make disinfectant in our laboratories, do masks and all that stuff. And ultimately that ended up in us getting active in the field hospital, you know, that we then gave our PE plant, old component factory that was converted with the help of the German government into a field hospital at the moment for 1,500 beds. And we are busy discussing with the Department of Health in which form or shape the balance of the about almost 2,000 beds come on top. So it's been keeping us busy. It was a hell of a couple of weeks that we've been on this. It's not easy. Business and government speak two different languages, so there was lots of interpretation and getting things to be done. But we saw it in the media. We got it right for the first phase, and I'm confident that we also do the rest now in the short term. So, yeah, a lot of nobody was bored. A lot of people working from home, which surprised me quite a bit, because we basically moved all admin that was not necessary to build cars straight away back home and gave them either laptops or dial-in possibility, and it works. I've been working from home for the last, I would say, 8 weeks. Very seldom I go to Utenhague, and gotta ask yourself if they actually need me. So I'm pretty confident it works. So yeah, so that's a little bit of the situation that we're in. We believe that this is not gonna go away in the next couple of weeks, so we still have to see this through. I know that this general feeling in South Africa is a bit like, okay, it should be over now, and can we move on? What about the masks and all that? I think we're heading into the hot phase of this pandemic. It's better to keep a watchful eye and make sure that we steer through the next 3, 4, 5 weeks with very open eyes. Yeah, so there's a little bit of where we are. And financially, we had a great year 2019, so we are okay. Obviously, lockdown and impacts cannot take much longer. Otherwise, every provision comes to an end. But for now, we are a sound business.
Thank you very much, Thomas, for that introduction. And as I said to you all, we will have an interactive session, and we are inviting the audience to start using the chat box to raise some issues or some questions for Thomas and I to deal with. You are welcome to also state where you're from, the company, or even the country, or wherever you're from. Please do state that. Thomas, just to quickly, just that short 5-7 minutes that you were talking, some very, very interesting things came out of that talk. You know, we are looking at your leadership at Volkswagen, you know, in the city, in our country, and also in Africa, what you've done. And of course, we know that your work is legendary. But, you know, what we are hoping to achieve as a business school is to sort of share these kind of experiences of people of your caliber with a wider audience, our students, our alumni, local businesses, our country. We can all learn from each other and, of course, make the world a better place. So I'm going to start with the field hospital. You know, it's a very favorite project of mine, because it talks about, you know, business, social responsible behavior. And, you know, I saw that on LinkedIn. I said, wow, Volkswagen for good. You know, and I think, you know, it's all about business for good. So we really, that's one of the key behaviors of your company. And maybe you want to share maybe just a few thoughts to where it comes from, how you actually got buy-in from your board of directors, your senior management, and of course, also the German parent company.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, the whole CSI space and, you know, being active in the community and in the country has always been part of our business. And we have Volkswagen Community Trust, which is at the same time above 100 projects that perpetually get worked with and funded, and trying to focus on aspects that make a difference. Now, so the last aspect we focused on strongly was literacy, when we saw that, well, about 3 years ago, that when the results came out that grade three learners, 70% of the kids in South Africa couldn't functionally read and write, which is a disaster. You know, these kids will never be employees of ours going forward, you know, because they never have the chance to proceed in school. So we immediately went on a mission there, and we do very focused stuff. We don't do the sort of handing out food and, you know, the normal stuff that the more social organizations do. We do focused stuff on literacy, on interventions that have impact and meaning, and hopefully will continue even after we step away from it. So the reading, learning was a big one. And I mean, in this context, when this crisis and this pandemic broke, it was very clear that you cannot leave the metro alone with this. They're not manned for this. They've got no experience in this kind of crisis management. And I mean, so we also don't have it, but we have it internationally. So from an international perspective, we have now the China experience. We had other disasters around the world that you know, the private business has to come to the help of the metro. So we decided, look, it's when the business chamber called for a meeting, and we went in with Andrew Meir, and we met John Black, the virologist, and he gave us the sort of the rough numbers of what they are forecasting for PE, what's going to happen. I literally almost had a heart attack, because the numbers, and I'm not going to repeat them here, were of such magnitude, and so far everything has been holding true, it's just on the way to there, that our people will be affected. This is our families, this is the workers that work in our factory, the suppliers at the broader society that we operate in, and we cannot neglect this. So we have to become active in this. And, you know, one thing was very clear. The board was immediately convinced, even our board in Germany. The great thing was, though, how the employees bought into this. Now, when we first informed them and said, hey, here's what we're going to do, we had unbelievable buy-in. They said, well, this is absolutely fantastic. You know, that gives you purpose in working for a company that, you know, it's not just about money or something. This is just, you know, we're doing something because we believe it's the right thing to do. So this, at the end of the day, I think we were just lucky that we had this facility that was available. We were trying to get other facilities. We looked at other facilities in the metro, and it's sad to say a lot of them sort of closed their doors saying, well, inconvenient, we can't do this. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we said, okay, what the hell, whatever, let's just do it. Huh? And we got the buy-in from the German government, who also believe that, you know, if we make the first step as Volkswagen, they can come on board and spend some money, because they know we'll put it to good purpose. So I think great for the employees. It has been a wonderful story that they can tell their kids. And I think it's a once in a lifetime event that we put together in this. And it came at the right time. I mean, as we know, we read the media, read the news. It's been a hell of a story. I don't deny this. Every time I have meetings with the Department of Health, I need heart medication afterwards because these folks work at a different speed than the private business. And I perpetually get told I mustn't be too German on them, but this is about lives. This is about people and saving this humanitarian mission. This is not about right or wrong or ideology. This is about getting the right thing done.
Thank you, Thomas. Thomas, I probably should not have chosen the field hospital as the first, example of the leadership that you have in your company and Volkswagen as a leading company in South Africa as well. But there's quite a number of chats and questions raised, and I'm going to work through a few of them. Some of them are just comments and others are actually questions. I hope maybe you can answer some of them, but certainly we have to also focus on the other aspects of your leadership. So firstly, coming from one of the attendees is, of course, well done with the Wellness Center. So the question is, how will this new environment affect Volkswagen? Should working be promoted by employers, or will you be looking at a different type of client? I'm not sure, Norman, that question is well understood for Thomas. I'm not sure. Maybe you can rephrase that question. I'll come back to you, Norman. But of course, another one obviously is the initiative for the field hospital. What is the plan to manage the necessary skills as we see or hear that we have a shortage of medical support? I know that you've had some challenges with the manning of the hospital. Can you perhaps just report on the progress there, perhaps?
Yeah. So let me say, first of all, I think the Department of Health has got issues. There's no doubt about it. They battle with unions. They battle with recruitment of staff. They're in some instances not. I don't think they got the magnitude of the story. Again, what we're trying to do here, you must just understand the size of it. The biggest hospital in America is 2,400 beds. Now we are putting the hospital together for 3,300 beds. It deserves some kind of attention to get it right. Now, we are not running it. We're not in the business of running a hospital as Volkswagen. So that needs to be done by the Department of Health, the way they run any other hospital around the country. So there's been a robust discussion between Department of Health and us, because we demand, we actually put it contractually down, that they need to come to the party. They promise to come to the party. At the moment, it's ramping up. We, in fact, have more staff than patients at the moment at the hospital. We get the stats, we get the figures, we got by Friday, we have the new manning plan and all that. What you've seen in the media is a disgusting attempt to use this as a political leverage to make other people look bad. And I'm not going to say who it was and what it was, the people that put it together should be ashamed of themselves to basically go into the hospital, film it and make it a political story. That's bullshit, it's about human lives. So I'm not going to comment on that. I can assure you that the hospital at the moment is well run. They're preparing for the ramp up. And luckily, there was no bigger influx of people in the past 2 weeks. Otherwise, we would have run into a problem, or they would have run into a problem, because they were not staffed for a massive influx. So, but now, by Friday, we have all the details, and there is enough to cater for. It's a field hospital. It's a overflow hospital. You know, this is not feel good wellness. Everybody's got a TV kind of thing. This is the alternative to lie in a tent in front of Livingston Hospital. Okay, so it's a decent place. People compliment it all along. And but again, don't believe everything that's been said in the media. It's a bit sad. Instead of helping and coming to the party and helping to get things done right, to like shout from the fence, not a great idea.
Thank you, Dion Joubert, for that question. Grant Mini from Propeller Business Incubator has got another question. I think you've partly answered it, but he asks, what are Volkswagen's plans with the field hospital after COVID or post-COVID?
So We foresee that the field hospital will no longer be required probably by March next year. That's sort of when you look at the forecast of the when the peaks coming and so on. So we believe by about March we can dissolve it, and then the everything that's in it will be donated to hospitals, schools, and everything. You can understand there. We bought of the 3,300 beds, we bought 800 top-notch hospital beds. Okay, they are immediately needed across the province. All the normal beds you can give to, I mean, there are plenty of people who need that. Plus the containers, we've got ablution containers that are put inside the facility, about 20 of them. They can, they're perfect containers. You put out, you know, lift them up and you put them in front of a school. There are toilets, showers, everything in them. So we believe everything that's in there will come to a good use. We'll, it's paid by the German government, and it will go in a second life to making doing something good as well. And then we sell. Then we sell the place.
So clearly, from the various contributions from the participants, there's a massive appreciation and thanks for Volkswagen and its initiative around the field. I'm going to move over to some other questions. I'm going to go to Kingsley's question around the learnings, the key learnings from the overseas factories to overcome the challenges and to keep business sustainable. You know, your experience is very, very widespread. And can you share some of those key learnings that are from your experience to overcome challenges in business?
Mm-hmm. So we, as I said earlier, we've got this 100-point catalog that we introduced in the factory from, you know, thermal cameras on arrival at the gates, where people's temperatures get scanned, then taken out for if the raised temperature, all the hands-free dispensers. We reorganize the workplace in a way that people are not too close to each other. If they have to work close to each other, they have got specific protective equipment. So there's a wide variety, and I'm happy to share this with anybody who wants to know it. So we are not, it's not proprietary information. You know, if anybody's interested, please reach out. I'll give you a copy of that, no problem. But the key, the absolute key, is testing. So you want to get people that show up with symptoms, you need to isolate them immediately, test them, and either send them home for isolation if they're positive, or go back to work. Now, the reason we have got 200 plus people that are missing from work is because testing has not been done properly in the whole country, for that matter. Now, we are not testing enough, and the testing period is far too long. So between testing and result, average 5 days. That's rubbish, because people who get tested and only get a result 5 days later, they can infect people on the 5 days. If they don't stay at home, we're going to spread even further. So we, from day one, we've been pushing the national laboratory here in Port Elizabeth, who were doing about 700 tests per day. We sent our production engineers in to help them reorganize the workflows, you know, reorganize the machines and everything. And they pushed it up with them literally to more than double, 1,500 a day. So we then used some of the money that we got from the German government. We bought two more machines, and that will be introduced by the end of the week. We'll get another 1,700 per day. And the point is, the quicker you test and you have a turnaround time, you should have a turnaround time of about 2 hours between test and result. Then you can isolate people, send them back to work, or send them home, and you have a short reaction time, and you can keep your business up and running. It's a huge mistake that the government has made over the last couple of weeks not to invest further in more testing capacity and capability. They're coming right now. We see that we in South Africa on average go do almost 50,000 tests per day, which is now quite okay. But in the beginning, we're bimbling along with like 15, 20,000, at a population of 55 million. That's not enough. And so key learning is, apart from all the hygienic measures and the stuff we organized on the workplace, testing. And now it's coming through. So late, but better late than never.
Thank you. Coming from Dr. Ruby Ann Levendal, I want to push some of the questions more towards your side. Is the whole question of what innovations did you and your team come up with to enhance your business processes in response to the pandemic and the lockdown to be still a successful business?
It's interesting. No? We've been battling with digitalization, obviously, as an industry globally. You know? The drive for digitalization is massive. The future electric cars are all connected cars. So you have a whole different setup there. And I always say jokingly, who is in charge of digitalization in the auto industry? Mr. COVID. So it's been driving the digitalization flat out. It's the whole customer journey from getting interested in a vehicle to purchases online, all the way to selling services online, stuff that we had not seen happening that fast is now happening, which is fantastic. So you have to sometimes something needs to chase you up to get out of your comfort zone. And if dealers are not open, and some of our dealers have been selling pretty well online right through the lockdown, you would think, wow, how is that possible? It's possible. So and same thing, like I said earlier, this working from home, can people work from home? Can they be trusted? They dial in from home, will they work enough? Guess what? I really think people work a lot more than they would actually at work. They're putting more hours in. And so it's quite refreshing to see how the work environment has changed and how people embraced it and moved forward. So I'm pretty psyched about this, and it will change the future of workplace and the future of working, I think, for time to come. We're pretty nervous if I owned lots of office space right now.
That's great, yeah. I've got a question from Sianga, from Marikizela, from Johannesburg. And the question is, what is the one leadership quality that you believe will get South Africa out of this crisis?
Well, look, South Africa obviously needs leadership. There's no question about it. And I always say this because I've got now plenty of experience around Africa. And you see certain countries moving ahead with strong leadership. We now have a great leader, Cyril Ramaphosa. I personally believe is doing a splendid job. Can criticize everybody for everything, but in this tough environment that we are in, we have not got a monarchy or we have a democracy. And now you can argue, the guy should have more rights and he should be stronger or whatever. Well, a couple of years ago, we were actually quite happy that we didn't have that. Otherwise, we probably wouldn't be around anymore. So I think that the one leadership quality is we have to have a common purpose. We need to get our people behind a common purpose to build up this country again. Now more than ever, we are about to hit rock bottom economically. We had years of friction. Now is the time to bring people together and do that with a strong hand. And I can only say that goes in every direction. And unfortunately, we have too many people shouting from the fringe, not enough strength in the core of the political arena. And that's perhaps something that needs to be strengthened, that you have a solid core and not the extremists from the left and the right, that everybody is looking left and right for what they shout from the fence. It doesn't help anybody. So I believe get a purpose, move on, and use this. I mean, a crisis, never waste a crisis, right? I mean, this is fantastic. We have now all opportunity to move out of this as one team.
Thanks, Thomas. I've got another question here, quite a lot of them still there. There's still 25 questions, so please take it easy.
I'm sitting
there's a question from Paul Kasund. Now, he asked the question, what can be done to improve the available talent pool in our country and in our city or the region, Eastern Cape, to contribute to our sector to become more competitive? What can we do to upskill and develop our people to be competitive?
Yeah, we have good initiatives that are sort of unlocking certain potential. The YES initiative, for example, we have seen some real raw diamonds coming through. We should potentially do, no, not talking for any industry specifically, but we should focus a little bit more on dual apprenticeship from my point of view, and I'll give a solid base. And not everybody needs to go to university and become a doctor or a professor, but we certainly need some people that can, you know, are good at their trades and get, you know, get a solid base. The secret of Germany has always been a strong trade, people that have businesses in the small and mid-size space, no? But with good skills. So I think we need to focus a little bit more on that. Our universities are great. There's nothing wrong with our universities, international comparison, or business schools for that matter. I think the focus needs to be more on the basic and medium skills that we need to get people into the workflow.
Thank you. Thomas, I think I've got another question from Kingsley that I thought we should actually bring back into the leadership in Volkswagen, so to say, and of course any company for that matter in the pandemic. You know, you asked the question, how will VW, for example, continue to produce if rising infections increase significantly in the workforce? How are you going to cope with that, and how are you going to remain still competitive and resilient as a company?
Yeah, as I said, you know, at the moment we can carry on because we've got 3 shift teams and then we're only running 2 shifts, so we can live out of the third shift pool, so to say. With the testing capacity that we've introduced now by the end of this week, and that's not only Volkswagen, that's for PE, right? I mean, we just benefit from it as well. We will be able to isolate people much quicker. You cannot avoid that whatever happens in the broader public arrives at the workplace. We can just hope that over time we are able to handle it out of the workforce that we have. I know it's a lot more difficult for one shift operating companies that have not got the luxury of living from a third shift, but I sincerely hope that we'll make it through the net this wave. The pandemic is supposed to peak in middle of August. And if the numbers are coming through that have been shown, then it could mean that we have to shut down as well, which would be a disaster. But we're doing everything in our power to keep it workable and keep it running. We'll see.
Yeah. Thank you, Thomas. I'm just working through more of the questions here. This one coming from Sanjeev Ranshot. The whole work from home or the remote working order, so to speak, how does it impact your staff performance, particularly admin staff having to work from home? Any changes in performance and delivery?
Yeah. As I said earlier, but I would say unbelievable how well that actually all worked. No? So everybody is sort of dialing in, and of course you've got all the funny things with people in pajamas and dogs running and kids running through and all that. But other than that, I would say performance being fantastic and things are working, from monthly reporting to our customer interaction center, the people that when somebody's got a breakdown, call in. Those people work from home, and guess what? It works fantastically. There's nothing wrong with it. So I was just laughing yesterday. I was speaking to one of my automotive CEO colleagues, and they said that they did a review in the IT department to check how the sort of dialing in performance and whatever of the employees is. And they found 12 employees had never dialed in since 12th of March. So obviously some take it a little bit more serious, but
liberty.
Others don't. Anyway, but we are quite happy. It's again, it will define how we work from here on. It's I might do home office days in between it. It's fantastic. Works.
I'm gonna give this question. Comes from Chris Pierce. He seems to know you very well. COVID has greatly impacted small and independent repairers. Large manufacturing giants protect their bottom line by locking consumers into warranties in order to capture service or parts revenue. With consumers becoming increasingly frustrated and the government looking at amending legislation to open up the service market, question: how are major companies looking to implement this onboarding, and what is the expected timeline, if you know, on this change?
I've got an inkling what he's talking about. let me try. First of all, this is a story about independent repairers and all of that versus service dealers and all that. We work with any company that has registered with us and that meets the standards. So that is not the same within the auto industry. So certain car brands in the market lock their people in for warranties and all that only with their registered dealers. We don't do this. So we have a clear policy, whether it's body repairers, whatever, you register with us, you meet the basic standards, there's no problem. So if that's the question, happy to pursue that further. You can contact me anytime.
Yeah, thank you. With this crisis having come upon us globally, nobody could have predicted it. We didn't see it, and we just sort of something that was thrust upon us, and we had to make do with a lot of changes. Coming back to a question from Dr. Ricardo James from Angeli, he asked a question: if you could go back into time, and you had a 3-month lead time before COVID-19, what would you have done differently? Or in other words, what specific managerial or leadership readiness which you have focused on for your team before the crisis?
Look, I would have invested earlier in testing. But other than that, we basically had a lead time, leading up to the lockdown and within the lockdown, able to react on it. China had no such thing. When Wuhan was hit, there was obviously nothing that they could prepare for. When Italy was hit, that surprised them. But when it came to us, we had a very slow ramp up curve. So we could have done better. And that's a sad part of it. If we had focused as a country better on getting our medical setup prepared for the onslaught, there's just too much red tape in our government about that. I mean, we made a ventilator, a normal ventilator, you pay about 500,000 rand, okay? So we made an emergency ventilator that does the trick, cost 10,000 rand. So we can make 100 of them in Utenet. We showed it to the government over and over and said, listen, I think before people, when like you have situations like in New York where medical staff has to make decisions, who gets onto a ventilator? Yes, no, 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 yes, because you have not got enough. We could have avoided that completely. We could have trained for it. We could have trained nurses. We get mobilized volunteers. We had all the time in the world to get ready for the peak. And we wasted that time. That's the reality. What you see now around us is simply getting overwhelmed by what we all knew was coming. And that's a sad part. We obviously a little bit better prepared in the metro now because we have a hospital and all of that, but unnecessary, completely unnecessary. So if I had to go back in time, I would probably throw my toys out of the cart a little bit more than I already did and force people for proper plans and preparation. I was a little bit too soft at one stage because I believed in the system and maybe thought, okay, they tell you it's all good and we can be trusted, but obviously not. Trust me once.
Thank you, Thomas. There's just another Gallup research that Lorraine Govender is bringing to our attention that proved that, during a crisis, this high engagement in teams. Was that your experience? Is it still your experience now? That your teams at VW are more engaged in productivity and commitment and so on?
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, in such a crisis, in any disaster like that, people look for leadership. And everybody wants to see the captain on the bridge, see what's going on and how we're steering through this, because people are afraid. I mean, this is this fear of death. I mean, you mustn't underestimate this. It's not just economic fear and what's going on. This is serious. So I would say the engagement with our employees that was absolutely key between the team managers and the employees all the way through the unions and shop stewards. We tried to keep as close as we possibly could with information all the time with our teams, and they appreciated it. I would say it's a good example of of what needs to be done. You need to be close to your people, and they responded. They all responded. As I said earlier, not only by appreciation of, you know, we like what you're doing, we think that's fantastic, but also by saying, hey, how can we help? You know, can we do something? You know, can we go out there and, I don't know, stitch masks or whatever? What can we contribute? Which I find amazingly motivating. That's the kind of sort of mindset that we're looking for.
Well, just as a side interlude, you recently awarded described as a laureate of the PR Works Golden Crown of Excellence. How did that hit you when you got that award?
I did get a reward?
The PR Works award for
That one.
Excellence.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Yes.
Oh, thank you. Look, I didn't expect that. I always say I get paid for this, so it's nothing that I do to look good or anything. My belief, this is what we need to do. Everybody needs to step up. You know? That they came up with this, I mean, I thank them for it. It's nice to be recognized, obviously, but there are more heroes than me in the city. You know, there's plenty of action. And now we have Isuzu coming to the party. They footed money like no tomorrow to make the logistics for the medical equipment and you know, where, I mean, equipment got lost. And this is the funny thing, you know, when we look at protective equipment of for the hospitals, when you look at what was sent and what arrived, you faint. Yeah. So we had to take action and say, listen, we need to assist. And what can we do? We're good at logistics as automotive and then plan things. So Denise and the team, you know, they jumped into it and they got that done. They went into the hospitals, Livingston, and pragmatically renovated a few wards that were condemned for I don't know how many years. So there's plenty of these things. You know, Coca-Cola came to the party. They immediately donated money and so on. So great examples where others also stepped up. It's not only me. It's just because yeah, Volkswagen is so prominent in this town. Obviously, people focus on us, but. I'm happy that I could pull this off, and I'm happy that it's now for the people of PE. So, yeah, it's fine.
Thank you, Thomas. The leadership in the crisis also requires a leader to be very, very visible, and to give clarity of purpose, and to be quite fast around decision making, and have the right information at your fingertips to make those kind of decisions. So, Sue Hageman from Harambee Youth asked the question: how have you made yourself visible as the captain of the ship when everybody else is working from home?
Well, I'm part of the, you know, every morning, 9 o'clock, we've got our COVID task team. So with the board plus all the sort of project leaders within the various fields that you obviously, I'm there every day. I usually walk the factory when I can, go to Utenegg, just walk around, show my face, plus mask, obviously. But you know, at least people know that they're not alone and they're in this together. We connected, I think we had more board meetings than I've ever had in South Africa since my arrival. There's continuous engagement, much more flexible, much more fluid, you know, like, okay, we have to have a meeting this afternoon. Okay, cool. 7 o'clock. Yep. Come together. 10 minutes. Let's go. So I've been connected to my team very well. Have I seen people that I normally see on the way into the plant in and out? No, probably not, but I think they can live without it.
It's all about communication, and communication is key. And there's so many comments on the chat box about your communication skills, and people are commending you and saying that is a very important attribute of your leadership, actually, the communication skills, and that actually helps with the visibility in the dispersed workforce.
Got a good communication.
Yes. So we've got some questions from YouTube coming through. I'm going to do one for now. Interesting question from Sizwe Matununu. She asks, will VW be recruiting at all during this pandemic?
We never stop recruiting for critical skills and for positions that are in any way sort of needed for future business. However, in this crisis, you know, we have to drive with the headlights on. So I cannot say, forever and whatever, we're going to start employing big time again. But for now, we've never stopped. And on the labor side, that will be a result of what the future looks like in the next few months. I mean, for this year, the numbers look catastrophic. You can imagine. I mean, this we had a drop from like 160,000 cars per year production, probably to 120,000 this year. So 40,000 cars, I mean, this is a nightmare. It is technically one shift. But when you look into the projections for that we get from sales for next year, internationally, for export and locally, we're back to 150,000, 160,000. So can it be trusted? I don't know. But to me, it means we're definitely not going to let go of a shift or anything. We're going to make sure that we hold on to them as much as we can. And we sort of drive through this pandemic so that we come out on the other side stronger. But no mass employment like we normally do when you have 50 people here or 20 there. It's good, critical skills, yes, specifically in digitalization, electric mobility.
The whole stakeholder community in business and in the economy also has, there's also a place for SMMEs. And you have mentioned previously that, you know, SMMEs is probably the backbone of the German economy. And Raymond, or was it Reynold, Reynold Solomon asked a question. Do you have any advice for SMMEs in Port Elizabeth, in our region? How do we actually develop them and how do we make them more sustainable to be meaningful contributors to the economy?
So SMMEs, I firmly believe that is the way to go going forward, but also to strengthen the economy and all. It doesn't mean, there was some movements in the past where SMMEs were almost vilified. They're the bad guys and whatever. That's, you know, there's certainly a couple of bad apples around and all, but that's in any business. So I think we need to have a stronger approach. What we learned in the building of the hospital now, the change over the hospital, we got a lot of flack all of a sudden by SMMEs demanding a portion of the work. And we're like, I'm not sure what you're talking about. You know, we can only give work to registered suppliers. And we found out that obviously there's a pool of SMMEs that have not even started to register with our Volkswagen supplier database. We cannot do business as a company with any company that is not registered on our business, that has not done a background check, that have not been done on compliance and integrity. So you cannot just give a job to somebody. So we did a registration drive and, you know, got the company to say, hey, you can put in your documents, let's get you on board. 40 companies registered and so on. So we need to, it's obviously a disconnect between how do you get business and you know, what do you need to do to, you know, get on board with the big guys. You know? So traditionally we look for obviously big contractors that bundle stuff. But for the future, we need all the SMMEs who are serious within their task to come on board and register with our company so that when there's a need for welding and cutting or whatever, then we also have them in our list and we don't always go to the same ones that are registered. So I learned a lot talking with them and looking a little deeper into the topics there. It pains me that when we did the first Black-owned Supplier Day in South Africa, in Uitenhage, how few automotive Black-owned automotive suppliers there are in South Africa. And that's not services. I'm talking about making parts or doing some sort of component preparation, stuff like that, you know, skills. So not cleaning and cooking and meals and that kind of stuff. And that needs to stop. If we don't start with a tier three, tier four suppliers that then bundle up ultimately into the big tier one suppliers, into the OEMs that manufacture cars, we're never going to get there. So this is a strong focus of us going forward. And I can only encourage every SMME to reach out to us and to the other big companies and register your business.
Thank you. There's one question that I missed earlier from Professor Elmarie Venter. The question is around the relationship between yourself and the mother company in Germany, and also the sort of latitude that you are given in terms of negotiating, for example, the field hospital. You've explained that already, but let's just maybe focus on your African expansion, the vision for Africa. I think it's your mobility sort of project in Africa. How does that vision, how was it actually negotiated, if I can use the word, with the mother company.
So one thing you need to understand is that Volkswagen is used to be a very sort of headquarter heavy company. So you were told what to do. Personnel choices were made by headquarter. Volkswagen South Africa was a bit more than a production site with the national sales company, but not responsible for Africa or anything around it. Now, when you look at South Africa and David Powell's, my predecessor, had put South Africa nicely on the map with a very efficient factory and so on and so forth. So South Africa was looked at as a good car producer somewhere far away from Europe. Okay? And when we looked at the way forward, now one thing becomes obvious is that producing cars in South Africa, where about 60% of the cars go into export to Europe, will become difficult for the future. Why? Because we are not a low-cost production site. South Africa, labor cost rising more than the inflation every year, already on the level of places like Czech Republic or Portugal. Lots of logistics cost for getting material to South Africa or localizing it here, plus sending completed vehicles back across the ocean for 3 weeks on water, brings you in a difficult position. So the rest of Europe at the moment, for example, is extremely pushy on electric vehicles. So the type of vehicles we all, 7 OEMs that produce in South Africa, all in traditional motor cars. So if Europe would switch off or would go stronger into electric mobility, our market is dead. We could, from today to tomorrow, we could be dead. And I said, same thing what happened with Great Britain. If the South African government had not negotiated a deal with Great Britain, we would now have import duty from South Africa into the UK after Brexit, which would have cost us 50,000 cars per year export volume. So we are far too dependent on Europe as an export destination. The rest of the world doesn't really matter. So we need to find a different profit pool and a different export destination to keep South Africa alive. And the only one that makes sense is Africa, which is on our doorsteps. If we don't get Africa right, we might as well say goodbye to the auto industry in the next 15 years. So the reason for us to move to Africa was very selfish. It was very much South Africa driven to make sure that we stay in business. However, at the same time, we realized our brothers up north and sisters, they want automotive industry. They want jobs. They want their youth to be employed, and they want same situation like in South Africa. We make 7% of the GDP of the country. It creates a million jobs in the supply chain and so on. So the idea to get Africa right can only be by working together, by a win-win, by having countries like, for example, Ghana now, to understand that they also want an auto industry. It's not about us sending as many cars as possible from here to Ghana. It's about getting Ghana ready for an auto industry and then start taking cars from Ghana, but also sending cars from here to Ghana, no? In a different kind of type or whatever. So our expansion into Africa is part of a strategic move to sustain South Africa as our home, but also to unlock the African continent, where literally at the moment nothing is happening in automotive, but it could be what we estimate 4 to 5 million new vehicles per year, new market that is not there at the moment. So we believe great opportunity, an absolute life vest for South Africa going forward, and something that just makes sense that we also, from a carbon footprint point of view, I mean, somebody's going to ask, what on earth are you doing? Why are you sending parts to South Africa, make a car, and then send the car back to somewhere else? Yeah? So do it in Africa. Do it for Africa. So that's what drove us. And it took headquarter a while to embrace it. And bottom line, I got that through mainly because of our diesel scandal that we had in Europe and in the US. And everybody was busy elsewhere. Huh? So I could say, we okay, let me do what we can do best. We're gonna get Africa right. So that's why they gave us the responsibility, and we moved. We took the chance and we went straight ahead. And I must say, development is fantastic. Got to switch.
And that is the epitome of leadership, I think, is about vision and knowing that there are certain times and adverse times that you have to have a vision for Africa. The African Mobility Project indeed is a very, very commendable one. And so it actually comes down to the wire if you want to look at the topic this afternoon, Thomas, about leadership in times of crisis. They say the true test of leadership is how well you function in a crisis. And judging on the chat boxes this afternoon, the participation by over 113 participants, and of course, people on YouTube, this is live streamed, of course, there was a clear and an emphatic vote of confidence in your leadership at VW and as a great business leader in our country and in Africa. And the messages coming here is overwhelming. I can't read them all. We want to certainly thank you for your leadership, for your integrity, for your humility, and also for your social conscience and social consciousness to actually make South Africa, our region, Nelson Mandela, and even our province actually a better place. To us from Nelson Mandela University Business School, our university, our Alumni Relations Directorate, our friends and partners, we want to thank the Volkswagen community for being a shining star during these difficult times and also to be there for our people during very, very difficult times. I've had the experience of being down at Volkswagen at the 30th anniversary of your trust. I know that you couldn't attend, and it was amazing to listen to the accolades of the people and the work that Vernon and his team are doing there. And of course, I also visited your pavilion at one point in time to witness some of the great things that were done by Volkswagen. But certainly, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your time coming here this afternoon. Thomas, our guest this afternoon, thank you for sharing your knowledge, your experience, and expertise with our audience. And once again, we hope to see you soon, and God bless. Thank you.
It's a pleasure. Stay safe.
Stay safe too. Bye-bye.